Hey there, how are you guys doing? Thank you for joining us. Just to let you know, the first two rows are the splash zone, so I'm sure. No, okay, just kidding with you guys. All right. So my name is Mark, and this is Mike.
How you doing?
And we are with a company called Anime Bento, and we got a nice little booth in the back of the convention center. But what we're here to talk about is basically the past, present, and future of anime goods. So I've been watching anime since I was 8 years old. I'm 31 right now, so full disclosure right there. Yes, been watching it for a long, long time. Yeah, I got a fish shake back there, good. When I tell people that I watched anime VHS by VHS, people are like, what's VHS? And but it was a really different experience, and yeah, it was a real big, it's a big change now with the climate of how things are. And we're gonna go over basically how things started, where things are, and where we believe that they will go. Thank you very much for the water. Yeah. It's very hard to walk all the way over here. So, there you go. So, we have probably one of the most iconic figures in anime culture. Anyone want to venture a guess on who that is?
No?
Huh? No, up there on the on our screen. Anybody know? Miku? Miku? Hatsune Miku?
Hatsune Miku.
So Hatsune Miku has been on the Letterman show. She's had a couple of concerts in Japan and the United States, was a spokesperson for Toyota in the United States. And interesting fact, she's not a real person. 100% completely synthetic. Even her voice was basically synthesized. People would type it up and she says whatever that they type on there. Kind of like Ron Burgundy, if you guys watch that movie. But yeah, so that's how big anime has gotten in the United States. And we're gonna take a little trip all the way back to the far, far 1900s, as my son likes to say, but it's actually the 1980s. And that will let you know a little bit about what people thought of anime back in the day. So Japanese animation, as it was called, because the term anime hadn't been coined yet, was basically a very primal form of animation. And those are some clips on it. As you can see, the moe factor or the current art style is not at all applied here. They look very serious, their proportions are kind of getting there, but it's not really anime as we know it now. Does anybody know what highly influenced the anime art culture? We do bribe people for answers. No? No? Okay. So Disney actually was one of the forefront inspirations for anime, and it's kind of funny now because you see more anime in like Frozen design style than you used to see before. But the father of anime who brought it over to, or brought in the art style to main culture in Japan, was heavily influenced by Walt Disney and the animation boom here in the United States, and he wanted that for Japan. And so a lot of studios started producing work as much as they could, but it was highly considered to be of low quality. Some of the issues were that they had poor motion, even worse lip syncing, and we'll get into that on how that actually comes into play. And it was actually used by the United States for cheap labor. So some people would send out anime to get done out there. Anyone seen G.I. Joe? Voltron?
Transformers?
Those were all Japanese-based production for American cartoons because the animation was actually far more affordable to have it done overseas. So that's what it was. And, okay, and then there was this huge revolution. Does anybody know what the main changing point was? Probably the most epic film, and I'll give you a hint, it's not Miyazaki. One of the most epic films that changed the way people looked at animation from Japan and the United States.
Akira.
Hoover Prize. Yay, Tokyo Ghoul Wafers. Yeah, we're not beyond bribing people here, so interact with us, please. So that's right. So we have Akira. All hail Akira. So that is a picture of not Akira. That is Tetsuyo, but he is the main character. And the reason that Akira was such a huge thing for updating the way things were is that it had so much better production. Animation is about 3 frames per second. The movie Akira had 160,000 single frames of production in it, making it one of the most most epic animes ever made, and it was a feature-length film, which was even bigger than anything else that most of the projects had been tried to accomplish. The other thing was that this was one of the first films that all the character voices were recorded after the animation. Now remember, we talked about how anime had horrible syncing. Well, in the United States, the common practice was to record everything, then sync it to animation. So they caught on to that, and this was a game changer for them. Now the animation is done either simultaneously with edits or done one way or the other. And then this was a huge capture for the American market, because if you look at any of the stuff, it came out around the time of Blade Runner, Aliens, you know, it was during that time that people were really interested in the sci-fi plots. And one of the other things that people found out that was very interesting is that it had $10 million production budget, which is, back in the 90s, was even bigger than it is now. That's a lot of money now. In the 90s, that's like twice as much. So it also touched on the Western influences taking over the Eastern culture, which at the time was a huge political thing in Japan. And people were starting to import and buy a lot more Japanese products. So the whole East meets West thing was huge in the United States. And when Akira came out, it just swept everything. It was after Akira hit the United States that actually the term anime, short for Japanese animation, came. There was also Japanime, which was a horrible name. I remember seeing that in a couple of magazines, and I was like, Japanimation, that's weird. Anime got shortened down, and now we're pretty much starting to see the climb of anime in the United States. So we'll move right along to how animation was more likely distributed when it first came over. So has anyone ever heard of these two brands? Yes. How about Animigo? Yes. Yeah. Okay. So if you know Animigo, then you know what it is to suffer with tracking and all of the VHS. And I'm gonna go ahead and show you guys what a VHS anime collection looked like at the very beginning. Boom. That's it. Pay special attention that they only have Slayers 1 and 3. No 2. You can't get any more. I'm not even going to look at Evangelion. Cutie Honey is really questionable on what's the content matter was there. They do have Ninja Scroll, so kudos for them. So the price of VHS when it first came over was about $60 a VHS. You know, Blu-rays, you know, collections, things like that, you can maybe run that high nowadays. But $60 for about, maybe two episodes if you were lucky. An OAV at the very end that was 15 minutes long. So it was hugely expensive to do it. And guess what? You had to buy it again if you wanted subbed or if you wanted dubbed. There was no dual audio on VHS. It's just one way or the other. A lot of watching anime was like this, boom. And there you go, over and over again, trading tapes out, watching it. That's what a binge watch was like back in the day. A lot of getting off your couch. So, and we'll talk about how binge watching and all that stuff affects things now. But basically, back in the day, that's what you had. You had a VHS collection, and everything was superly expensive.
Yeah, I just want to throw in, we had quite a few people that walked in. If you guys participate and answer questions and get involved, we will give you free things.
Stuffs. So the history, I guess you guys are barely catching up. I think we're getting closer to the time that most people started to watch anime. So we'll go ahead and move on to the next slide. This is something that's familiar now, but maybe not as you knew it then. So bootlegging. Everybody here knows about bootlegging, right? Piracy, all that kind of stuff. This is something that the anime industry is really trying to get a hold of. It's not something that actually supports the industry. It doesn't help anything. It's actually a negative on that.
You're just moving it closer.
Okay. All right. But back in the day when VHS was $60 for two episodes and you had to order them through a magazine and hope you got them or sign up for a book club and somehow get them in that manner, the easiest way and most affordable way was bootlegs. And what you would do is you would find these people who did bootlegs, and they were normally Japanese appreciation clubs or cultural clubs, and you would send them VHS tapes through the mail, and about a month later they'd send you one back. and that one would have a couple of episodes. And their actual titles were rotating depending on if the licenses were picked up by the United States or not. Because right now we have simulcast, which is an hour after it comes out over there, you get it here. That's so fancy. I mean, I'm talking about waiting maybe 6 weeks to get an episode, and then you can't get any more because if someone's already picked up the license for it. So, I mean, at least they were conscious in that. They weren't trying to steal from anybody. They used to have these rigs like this, which if you ever lived in the 80s and you were trying to make copies of home movies, that's what you had to do. You had a collection of VHS that streamed, each one being worse and worse in quality. And so you just had static. They would hook them up to each other, run master copies that were actually copied from Laserdisc, which if you don't know what that is, I'll show you in a little bit. And those were the best copies. But it got a little interesting a little later on when people tried to sell these bootleg copies. So if you look here, it's of course a copy of Dragon Ball Z. And at the very bottom, it's kind of hard to read on the projector, but it says, "Don't you think Hank whines a lot and complains for just a little too much for selling some of our tapes," essentially is what it says. I'm having trouble reading it on my screen over here. But basically, it's the fan subbers complaining that Hank, who owns a local comic book store, sells the bootlegs to people when they're giving them away for free. Because if you sent it out, you got it for free. They didn't charge you. It was just to spread the culture of anime. So they started putting it over the credits and in between things like, "Hey, don't sell this. This is for free," you know, that kind of stuff. And it was kind of an interesting thing to see these. Sometimes there would be one guy in the back of the convention center with a bunch of cardboard boxes and VHS tapes with no covers, and he was selling you bootlegs. And like I said, sometimes that was the easiest way to get what you needed to watch, or the only way to get certain titles. So they started fighting back with a little bit of PR campaign doing that kind of stuff. And it's just made for an interesting culture. All right. So we've covered anime and how anime looked, but there's the other side of anime goods, which is merchandise. And if you used to actually have a collection of anime goods from back in the day, this is what you collected. Does anybody know what that disembodied anime piece is with no color on the right?
Yeah.
No, well, the one over there, the tall one. Does anybody want to know, guess what that is?
The garage kit.
And who said garage kit? Right over there. Give that guy a prize. Yeah. So a garage kit is exactly as it says. Basically, you have to build them. They were for hobbyists. You could not go out to a convention floor and buy a fully painted, fully assembled work of art as we have it now. So now are the good days where you can get your favorite characters just maybe within the same month that they come out. Before, they used to be manufactured and then shipped out, and you had to finish them, which led to some really cool looking artwork that people produce from them. You know, alternate colorings, really fantastic pearlescent, you know, coats, all kinds of really great things. So it's kind of a lost art form now. You can still get them, but most people are just wanting to buy the pre-painted ones. And then we have Gunpla. Yeah, the Gundam. Anywhere from beginner to perfect grade. Those things can take hours to assemble, and I think only the most dedicated fans really mess with that stuff. But that's what it looks like. Has anybody ever put together a Gundam set before? Yeah, I'll light a candle for you guys, man. That's vigilance right there, yeah. Yeah, I sat down in the corner of my office. I'm like, I'll get through this in an hour. Like 4 hours later, I was skipping dinner, and I was like, I just want to finish my Deathwing. Just put that up, and then it falls over and a piece breaks and you're like crying. But yeah, so as you can see, these Gunpla are made of so many different intricate pieces, and they're pretty much straight from manufacturer to you. And for all those who are fans of the Gundam, you are not alone in your efforts. That is a 5-foot Gundam made out of all the extra pieces that you get from Gundams, and they're all color coded as such. So yeah, it's great stuff. So that's pretty much how it used to be when it came to figures and stuff. So now we're gonna go ahead and catch up with the future. And with the future comes technology. And so that huge Tron-looking disc is a laser disc, which when I was in school, those were the best days when they would bring out the cart. And having a Super Nintendo, I was the only one who could hook it up. Nobody knew what the hell it did and how it worked. And so, yeah, laser discs were huge. You can see them in the background of Back to the Future. They're all bundled up as trash because, well, they're pretty useless nowadays. But those were also the best copies you can get. And side note, the best copy of Star Wars you can get. So in case you're into Star Wars, get it on Laserdisc. And then here's some things that you may or may not know depending on how old you are. So at the very bottom is something called MIRC. Anybody know what MIRC is? Oh, I'll give that guy a prize. Even I don't know the acronym. So
MIRC is the specific client.
The client for it, right. So yeah, it's basically like a chat room-esque, but you have to, there's addresses. Correct me if I'm wrong, because I didn't have internet at that time. But there's like specific ways to get into these chat rooms. People are looking very confused, like, what the hell? But yeah, basically, imagine if this room is one chat room, and the next room is another chat room, but there's no hall to connect them. You have to directly know the address, and people would share links and files peer-to-peer. And then that started the whole like Napster peer-to-peer craze with brands like Kazaa and BearShare. No? Nobody?
Yeah.
Yes, yes, LimeWire. So yeah, that was all peer-to-peer stuff. It was pretty much the easiest way to trade files. And again, we don't have an abundance of licensing yet. So I remember watching Bleach, Naruto, and all of those as they came out in Japan. It was maybe took about a 3 days for them to be subtitled, but they were not licensed in the United States, so you couldn't watch them. I mean, that was just the only way. So that's basically technology catching up to the media. And now we have our mainstream. And so our mainstream, our mainstream, we now show a new collection here of DVDs and such. So comparison to the small, pathetic cardboard box of VHS, people now have walls of media. They're able to see whatever they want. The whole DVD series is let loose, and people are able to enjoy them as they want. And you can even get them at Walmart. So no more mailing things out, no more begging and pleading on chat rooms. You know, no more minimums of how much information you have to share in order to download stuff. You can get it at Walmart. And I say that a little bit with a sigh, because at the beginning, you used to really have to be a fan. There was a struggle. Yeah, you really had to want it. And then there was always the looks of like, why aren't you just watching regular cartoons? I'm like, I love Gargoyles and, you know, Ninja Turtles and all that stuff.
In high school, we used to trade Rama One Half.
Yes,
like,
Rama.
VHS,
that was my first anime.
Yes, that was my first anime, yeah. Rama One Half. We used to have to trade the VHSs and all yeah. Like,
give her a prize. So if you haven't watched Ranma, you need to go back and watch Ranma. It's classic. It's always great. So now we are able to order things online, which was a big change for stuff. Amazon was pretty much, they call it shopping 2.0, where you were able to order things online. And that means straight from Japan to your house. It maybe take a little bit, but you were able to get things as you pleased. And then basically Americans started seeing that there was a market. We have anime conventions now where you can legitimately buy things, and everything is starting to come into place. I think even Hot Topic, you know, they have t-shirts and all kinds of stuff. So it's a really great way of being able to buy stuff now. And that was pretty much how it started. So we have a little bit of a technology burst now with how much internet is available to people. And that brings us here to streaming. Streaming has to be the best advancement to anime. I mean, coming back from when you had to watch them 2 episodes at a time and hope that they came in on time, now it's all simulcast. 1 hour, you have Crunchyroll, you have Funimation, you have Netflix, Hulu. It's pretty much available to you on any platform at any time. I see people eating their lunch at a convention, catching up on their anime. You know, I've done it before on the trips between anime, where we're starting to try to catch up with it, so that way we know what's still good. And just because, I mean, good anime is good anime, no matter how you watch it. So that's a real big advancement, and it's probably more commonplace now. So I'm hoping that, you know, introducing how it used to be and how it is now really makes you appreciate maybe how easy it is to watch new anime as you like. Yes?
I tell my son all the time, I'm like, you're so lucky.
Spoiled.
You get to scream it all the time. Right. It wasn't like that when I was young.
It wasn't.
Nothing. Yeah. You can just click a button. Because he gets to mark where he's at all the time. And get to watch all these episodes back to back, and go from one series to the. I was like, I didn't get. I used to have to watch one petty little series.
Yeah.
Got it. One episode.
I used to record Gundam Wing from Toonami after school, and if I got home late, it was only like half an episode.
I used to sit on my VCR every night. Yeah, especially when they would show it late night. You know, you couldn't stay up for more than to see an episode.
Or to watch the stuff that Stars had sometimes.
Yeah.
And it was like kind of weird, like Gender Blue.
Was it an international channel?
No, I didn't get it. I lived in a really small town, so.
It had Slayers and stuff.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Slayers was always hard to catch, too. Yeah, Slayers would come on every now and again, like Adult Swim
right.
somehow or something. It was just such a pain. And I tell him, like, you're so lucky you get to screen stuff.
It's very different.
And most of the time, they wouldn't even air them in order.
No.
Yes, you would have to watch them out of order. You would just have to, because you could be in no choice.
But you never knew what it was called, because they would just skip the intros and all that stuff, and it's like, anime, here you go, or Sailor Moon at 5 a.m.
And then eventually you can find out, like, oh, that's what I was watching.
Yeah.
I've seen this, what is this?
What
somebody would tell you, like, oh, I've seen that.
The one with the guy who puts his fingers and he shoots a gun. It's like Yu Yu Hakusho? I don't know. The one with the girl where she transforms.
The screening has made it so unbelievable.
Yeah. It's a whole new world for you guys.
I can't keep up for it. I don't have
enough
time.
Is it steamy?
I would never leave the house.
Thank you, I'll fix that. So my hard drive crashed last night, and I built this at midnight, so sorry about that typo. I'll fix that. You have a question back there. I see you.
Y'all can't spell.
Yeah, we just got that. But she was much nicer about it. Oh, I'm sorry, I have a microphone. I'll let them know. I'll yell. Yeah. So let's go past the typo page. Yeah, I know. I said I did that at midnight, so just let you know.
Excuses?
Oh, only because you have a better beard than me. So we have the future of anime, which is streaming, mobile content, anytime, anything you want. So what's the future of anime goods? When is anime goods going to catch up? And this is where we start shamelessly plugging our company. But before we do that, the picture on the right-hand side for you is a 4D printed image of a figure. And as you can see, is it their left side? It's their left side. Okay, I also don't know my left and my right. So before that happens. Okay, but basically that picture of a witch or cloaked girl, whatever, that is a 3D printed image that has also been applied with different colored plastics to produce almost something that is pretty sellable, I would say. And so with a lot of the new home fabrication, if you will, I'm pretty sure we're getting close to the point where people are going to be designing their own goods, where you'll be able to buy plans. I know they already have websites for 3D printers where you download a plan, you 3D print it, you assemble it, and we're almost coming back to the point of garage kits, but I'm thinking that a lot of the stuff is going to be going with 3D printing. I know with Good Smile, they're kind of leading the technology edge of that kind of stuff, and they're in-house prototyping their own stuff, so they're able to make a lot more prototypes, make the mold perfect before they send them out for production. And it's going to be a matter of time before people start just producing their own anime goods at home, where you would buy the plans or the licenses to do it. And so that's where I foresee things going. And also when it comes to like internet purchasing, like I said, when Amazon kicked off Shopping 2.0, it was a big trend. It was new, like, hey, I don't have to leave my house. I can order things from anywhere in the world. It gets delivered. And so a new trend that's happening now are the subscription boxes. Loot Crate, who, you know, we've had the privilege of meeting and talking, they kind of did that for geek culture, where you can get their boxes and every month that you receive new items. And so one March, we were sitting around and Mike was like, we need to do this for anime. And I wholeheartedly agreed, because I wanted one for myself. So we needed to get it done. So we put together Anime Bento. We've just completed our first year. So we've had all these boxes go out. We ship around the world. And basically, it is a subscription box that's filled with anime goods. If you go by the booth, you probably heard our spiel. They contain training figures, accessories, and snacks. You get about five to six items in each box in there. And then we do all kinds of cool incentives, like give away large scale figures and things like that as well. And this is kind of what our website looks like if you're interested in checking us out. We'll have a little group meeting about the struggle of the 80s and 90s in a little bit. But yeah, basically what we do is we're trying to change the way that you buy anime goods. Because there is so much anime coming out and so many things to purchase, it is difficult to keep track of everything. So what we do is we work with some of these production companies. Like, we've had the privilege of talking to Trigger. They did Kill la Kill and a lot of Little Witch Academia. And those guys are really cool, and they're about cutting edge stuff. They want to work with Netflix, and they want to get original content. They did crowdsourcing for Little Witch Academia. And so we're trying to work together to get their products straight from them to you guys. And we're doing that with a lot of up-and-coming anime titles. Like, we did Concolay, which is Kantai Collection, Battleship Girls, in case you don't know the name of it. But we were plugging that stuff for about 3 months before the anime came out. And we just wanted to get you guys excited about new stuff that's coming out that we think is good and what we believe would be very popular. But we always have our classics like Sailor Moon, Naruto, Bleach figures. All these items are in there. But yeah, it's an interesting way to get it. You're guaranteed a box every month as long as you sign up before the cutoff, which is normally about 10 days before the end of the month. And you get that box. Do you want to show them what a box looks like, opening up one? So we've had people commenting saying, like, it was Monday and I came home from work and had a really crappy day, but your box made me feel a little bit better. Because it is a little bit like an anime convention in a box. So even if you can't make it out, you still get all the loot and awesome stuff that you would want in there. Blind box, trading figures, gachapon, clear files, all kinds of things that, I mean, we like, so we put them in there. But we have a really big community on Facebook, 10,000 strong already, that are just telling us what they want in the boxes. And we're starting to engineer them a little bit better. So with everyone who joins our subscription community, we start tailoring them depending on what you guys are interested in. So that's how we're trying to change the way you buy anime goods. You don't always have to know what's good. You don't always have to keep on top of trends. We send you a nice little sorted box of samples, basically, that gets you what you want. So yeah, if you go to our website, you can save 10%. It's product code SJ10. So that's good for all y'all who are here at the convention. Our Facebook constantly has prizes, giveaways, as well as coupon codes. Oh yeah, we're giving away some stickers, so you can put them on your car or random strangers, whichever you like. But yeah, that's pretty much how we have felt that anime has grown over the time. Like I said, it started as a subpar art form to something that's influenced things like Avatar, The Last Airbender, you know, the Wachowski brothers, hugely accredited anime for the Matrix series. You know, anime has become hugely influential now to us, and we're really trying to just figure out new ways to get people interested in it. So at this point, we're willing to answer any questions that we think we can answer. Please don't ask us to spell anything. I guarantee nothing. So yeah, does anybody have any questions about either the timeline that we went over or our product?
You get free stuff.
Yeah, free stuff over there. What's up?
Is it like just like a box filled with random stuff, or do you like,
okay, so yeah, we have hundreds of subscribers. We're really on the brink of almost 1,000 subscribers now, and it would be pretty impossible for us to make custom boxes for everybody. What we do offer is a teaser image at the beginning, because we know a lot of people like the element of surprise, and we tell you what licenses are going to be there, like Sword Art or Tokyo Ghoul, or you know, that kind of stuff. And we put up a teaser image, and you guys have the option of actually skipping the box if you're on a subscription. So what that means is if for 1 month we say Tokyo Ghoul and you're like, hell yes, and then next month we're like Sailor Moon, and you're like, oh, not so much, you can hit skip. And then the next month that comes up, you already have your credit for that. So you never lose any money, you can skip a box. If you do month to month, there's no contract, no commitment, it's just up to you. If you end up signing up for 3 or 6 months altogether, then you end up saving a little bit of money as our thank you. We also do something called a Big Bento. And a Big Bento is a collectible crate. Last month we gave out a Monster Hunter treasure chest, and that was filled with about 5 figures. We gave out a messenger bag inside of it. And the girl who got that, her mom actually wrote to us because it was her first month signing up, and it was her birthday that they got it for. So she ended up getting her Bento and the Big Bento at the same time, and she's like, look, I don't know if you made a mistake, but we got 2 boxes, and one of them was huge. And we're like, no, congratulations, you know, have a happy birthday. So it's really nice. But, Did you have a question?
Is the Big Bento like a random giveaway, or
yes.
Are you...
Yes. So everybody who subscribes gets one entry into the Big Bento. And everyone who subscribes for 3 months gets two entries. Everyone who subscribes for 6 months gets three entries. And that repeats every month. Every month. Yes?
Does everyone get the same box?
Yes. I want to say yes. Most of the time we have enough product, but because everything is coming in directly from Japan, sometimes there is not sufficient amounts, but we give people basically the same type. I think this last month we had two different series of Cardcaptor Sakuras that went out, but it was Cardcaptor Sakuras. One of our months actually though, we had like, I want to say like 20 different options, a variety of them, but you were guaranteed like one from each pool. It was five, it was 20, 25. Yes?
So when you say like an entry, three entries every month,
yes.
So like, is it once you subscribe, like it re-enters?
Yeah, every month is a new drawing. Yeah, the only people who aren't able to win it a second time is the people who, I mean, yeah, people who've already won it, they get taken out of the pool. But we've not had a repeat yet. Yes?
Is it mainly popular anime, or is it kind of a mix of unpopular and popular?
I would say it's a mix, because, oh, go ahead.
Well, it's a mix. What it is, it's actually really just new things. The things that we get directly from Japan are things that are being made in Japan. So, if you've gotten things like Loot Crate or anything that's done as domestic stuff, those products are actually sold in Toys R Us, Walmart, and they order millions of those products, and they'll have some surplus left over. So it's pretty easy to get almost all the same stuff or here domestic. But when we order something like this, this is actually, you can't find this anymore. Once the pre-order goes out for all the stores, once that pre-order is done with, you can't order anymore.
Yeah. The manufacturer will have a run, and basically we have to order everything about 3 months in advance. And once that run is done, they're gone. You can't get those figures. I mean, somebody might be reselling them, but there's only a limited amount. So every box has limited edition items in one way or another. Sometimes it's things that we directly get from them, the licensing people, and sometimes they're just small run batches that are produced. But as far as titles go, it's a mix, because there will be Sailor Moon things that are currently popular now, but then some people are like, can you give me Urosario Vampire? And I'm like, I wish I could, but they're just not making it anymore. And even Naruto is already on its last run of production items. We're not seeing new things coming out. So it is whatever is available now. We're not buying up warehouses with clearance items, things like that. We're ordering them. So the way I like to say it is, if it hits the streets in Akihabara, that month we normally put it in our box. So, yes, back there. For the actual anime anniversary, I want to say that sometimes the stars come together and we can get a box with like multiple items, but in actuality, the manufacturers just make like one run of Sailor Moon things. We normally are pretty good about running the series if it has like phase one, phase two, phase three. We're pretty good about keeping up with that. So if you subscribe with us, we'll normally get the whole series out to you eventually. Yes? Transformer, not particularly. We also have to fit everything into this box, and we like we say, we guarantee you about, you know, five or six items in this box. So if the Transformers don't release anything that's small enough to fit in here,
and it's not to say that they won't or that we won't, but if it's a new item, then we're definitely gonna get it. We stay on top of that. Like I do all the product purchasing, that's why I'm answering the question mostly. But as soon as the item gets released, we pick it up. We pick up the pre-order, and if we don't order enough, we have to split the order with another one.
We also are producing some original content. We worked with a really great illustrator, and we produced our own mascot character. Her name is Moe-chan. Funny story about Moe-chan is the first time I ever went to a maid cafe in Tokyo, that was the name of my maid. So when we were sitting around just trying to figure out what to call her, I looked at my little autograph picture where I'm like crying, and it said Moe on there, which means cute, you know? And so we figured that it was an easy enough name. Some people like to call her Mo-chan, and I'm like, eh, I guess. But it's, yeah, Moe-chan is our original character. We produce t-shirts. Model my t-shirt for me. There you go. So that went out in our April box. We're working on producing all kinds of stuff, working with wall scrolls. Yeah, little mini wall scrolls with her. And like I said, I like to say we're buds with Trigger, but we've hung out with them a couple times at a bar. And
that's how you do business.
Yeah, that's how you do business over there. And we're really trying to work out a deal where they'll start maybe producing some original content for us. So that's like having a guest artist doing that things for us. Yeah. Yes.
When you get the boxes, is it always new things, or is there sometimes where you get some old things with them?
Yeah, most of the time it's new things, and I only say that because I think on very rare occasions we've had a huge spike. Like we'll attend a convention, and there's 10 extra boxes that we didn't budget for. We've gotten a lot better over our year, but yeah, most of the time you're going to get a brand new box. All the boxes are going to be very similar, if not exactly the same. And I think the only times that we've ever put an overstock item, like some of the ones we're giving away here, is if you're a new subscriber, which means it's something you haven't received anyways. But we try not to do that. It's normally, it's like a no.
So I mean, also, if you're talking about older, like older series, we do that sometimes. I mean, like this last month we did Fullmetal Alchemist, and that's just because we also work with Great Eastern, and Great Eastern had. Is able to produce a lot of the older stuff, but there's still new products.
Yep.
What about re-releases? Because everything's getting re-released every now and then.
Sailor Moon Crystal.
Yeah, if something gets re-released, we'll definitely jump on it unless it's something we've already done.
Right.
And it's only merchandise. There's no like, there wouldn't be like a disc or anything, or like, remember how they used to do those discs? Like,
are you talking about Columbia House? Where you send them a penny?
No, okay. the
previews.
Yes. So we're actually in talks with Funimation about doing that kind of stuff. Nothing's been settled. Like I said, we're only a year old, but we're really trying to change the way things are get released. I mean, getting a season one episode of like five different episodes to get you hyped about the season would be great. It's something that I've proposed to them. We recently started doing manga, and that was a real big pain in the butt because everyone wants volume ones. And not everybody has volume ones, but we did it. I mean, this last month went out, and we had a whole bunch of volume ones that went out there. And we had to clear the shelves of a couple of Barnes & Nobles in Austin. But, you know, we got number ones for everybody, and that's kind of what we're trying to do. We ask questions at these conventions, and one of the things people said is like, yeah, mine was cool, but I don't want volume 35. You know, I want volume one. And so we do that. The t-shirts are also something that we work with. Yes.
Where are you guys based
at? Austin, Texas.
Okay,
yeah.
That's what I was curious. When you say Austin, I was like, where?
Yeah, Austin, Texas.
That'd be another project
thing. Yeah, that's where we're based off of. It's actually a really nice central location. We're able to hit the West Coast, East Coast. Somebody in Alaska told us they got their box 2 days after we sent it, and that was awesome. It was during the flooding time of like Houston and all that stuff. So I live in Round Rock, right outside of Austin, and I didn't get mine for 4 days, but Alaska got theirs in 2 days. So yeah, USPS.
Well, also if that says anything, he purchases the box outright, like 100% pays for the
service.
For the service, and I mean he can just literally just reach out and grab it.
Yeah, I mean the whole point of that was to make sure that the experience is the way that we plan it to be. So yeah, I purchased it. I put it together. I never put together my own box. They're all random. And then someone else puts the labels on them usually. And then, yeah, maybe about a day or two later, it's in my mailbox. And I wanted to make sure that, you know, the whole experience is done the way that we want it to be. Sometimes we see crush boxes when they do box reviews on the internet, and I cry a little bit inside. But the guys are normally like, yeah, the post office kind of like threw it on my porch or whatever. Which is another part that we try to push a lot. We say that you can be internet famous with Anime Bento. And what we actually do is every month we look for the best reviews of that month and we share them on our page. And like I said, we're over 10,000 people on our Facebook. We're building up our Twitter and our Instagram. So we help people in our community who are excited about our product. And I'm not talking about just the people who make us sound good. Some people compare us in the same month to Loot Crate. Some people compare us to other ones. And basically, as long as they're not like cursing up a storm about it, which this last month, like 4 out of 5 reviews for people just excited that they cursed so much. But yeah, they were just good reviews, you know. If it's, sometimes they give us a really fair review where they're like, it was good, but I kind of feel it wasn't worth my money, but I like all the items, but damn, it's expensive, that kind of a deal. And it just really depends from person to person. Some people are like, it's totally worth it. One of the things that we kind of brag about is, and I'll use this as an example, is we have a Sailor Moon figure, Crystal 20th anniversary, and we bought them in Japan, they came out, and you know, at the time they were worth like $12, $15 as we normally price them. Then a few months later, they stopped selling them, $25 each one. So if you buy them on Amazon or eBay, they retain their value. And I mean, as a collector myself, I'm never selling my figures, but it's nice to know that I made a good purchase 3 months ago, and now my purchase has kind of like come back to me. At least I feel that way. But yeah, so that's Anime Bento. I don't know if we have time, but yes.
Oh, so you said that you just randomly have it and someone else just shits it?
No,
so,
well, we do it.
Well, so, someone else in the company just shits it. So have you ever gone like your own bento box and like realized you packed it yourself?
Yeah, well, I mean, they're all like that. See, the thing is that there's three of us in the company, and we are the entire staff of the company. Yeah, yeah. So we're the co-founders, and then he does all the ordering, I do all the marketing. The third partner who's coming down after his day job to help us out, he does all of the logistics to get it out to you guys. So yes, I packed my own box.
Oh, I thought it was like large enough. So
no,
like,
you know, I mean, we try to act real like high and mighty and stuff, but no. Yeah, it's just three guys in a garage right now. But yeah, we're growing pretty quick. Like I said, we're reaching almost 1,000 subscribers after our first year. So yeah, we've captured the attention of Funimation, of Loot Crate, of all these people. They've contacted us saying, you know, good job, thank you for not messing it up, you know, that kind of stuff. So. Yeah, we try really hard to do it, and mainly the reason that we do it all ourselves is because we want it done right, and it's difficult to, you know, put all of that, put your baby in someone else's hands and say, you know, raise it right. So until we get to the point where we can't handle it ourselves, then we will. But you know, it's a really good way to learn your business inside and out, so that when someone else does come around to help you with it, you can tell them, oh, well, I did it in a, you know, it's like Tony Stark building that Iron Man suit in the cave. It's just like that, you know. I can do anything now. There's no reason you can't do it. So, yeah, sorry, I kind of went off there. So, yes, any more questions? I think we got time. Any complaints about the 90s? Yes?
the spices sign up at those $10 a month.
Right.
Like different tiers, or?
You want to answer it?
Go ahead. Yeah, no, that's, well, they're not tiers per se. They're just how long you want to commit for. That $30 is actually a, it's a 6 month commitment. So it starts out at $35 a month if you want to just do month to month. For the 6 months, you pay for the full 6 months up front, but you're pretty much getting $5 off the box. And the way I like to phrase it is at the end of that 6 months, that last box is pretty much free, if you look at it that way. But yeah, so that $30 a month is the is our 6 month commitment. But in addition to that, you get saved 10% off of that order as well.
Talking about free boxes, make sure to go by our booth because we have raffle tickets. And at 5 o'clock, we're going to be giving away prize packs as well as a free month subscription. So if you guys are interested in trying it out, stop by. We'll get that. Yes?
Do you sell like
the Digimon? Yes, actually. Well, I shouldn't have said that, but yes, we have some Digimon stuff coming up later because the Digimon's getting a reboot. So. Okay. It'll be out in November with the DigiDestin. Yes?
But if you miss a box, oh. First
you're
going to buy
that? No. No, each box is limited to that month. I mean, if, and that's a big if we have extras left over, you could contact us and, you know, maybe we can get it to you. But a lot of the times we order just enough because we're constantly growing, so we have to project what's going to be there. We didn't have that many left over.
Yeah, I mean, this last month, we actually sold out.
Right.
A couple days before the cutoff.
Yeah.
So the only boxes we had left over this last month was something that we wanted to bring here to show you guys and stuff that we sent to reviewers.
Right. So if you do have a YouTube channel and you have, you know, what we really look at is basically over 1,000 viewers, like subscribers. And what we do is we issue codes to those people, and they're able to review their box, and then you can get a code to refer people. And if we start seeing that you're referring a good amount of people, we make sure that you get those boxes every month. You know, if it is something that you decide to do on your own, because we have several reviewers who don't meet our criteria yet. They purchase it themselves, they do it, we keep an eye on it. Basically, if you hashtag it correctly or share the link, we look at how many people are viewing it, and if it pops up that we see that it's a good fit for us, then we send you a box. We've done that a couple of times to different people. We work with cosplayers who are you know, just really good at what they do, and they do unboxings on their channels. But yeah, we'll help you guys out if you help us out, pretty much.
No. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Didn't that film Spirited Away also help
in
the anime industry a little bit?
Yeah, I would definitely say the Miyazaki movement was really good, because Disney ended up picking it up and started promoting it under the Miramax, or Buena Vista title. So yeah, Buena Vista was kind of Disney's experimental label. They would put it out and be like, okay, it's popular now, it's Disney, you know? Kind of like Miramax, which is, I want to say, Warner Brothers, and that's how they did Nightmare Before Christmas. And now Nightmare Before Christmas is part of Disney. So it's kind of like a lot of these companies will use different companies to do a Pioneer and ADC, or is it ADV? ADV Video. Those were all kind of the same company, but they were using different titles to attract or try to do different markets kind of deals. But definitely Miyazaki, with their theatrical releases, definitely did push it forward. And it's continuing to do that now. I'm waiting for my Totoro Land at Disney World to come by.
And they just announced the collector's Hayao Miyazaki Blu-ray collection.
Nice.
So it has 13 discs plus some other stuff that aired in like the 70s and 80s.
We should totally order that. So, yeah, is there something maybe that you guys want to see through our company produce? Like, one of the things we're throwing around is a premium box. And so the premium box would basically have a larger size figure, like an Android or a Figma, or something much bigger than a trading figure in there. But of course, you know, with the cost of those items, we would have a higher price point. And that's something that people have asked us to try to produce for them. Any kind of comments maybe about the business and things like that? Because this is also a learning experience for us, as you guys are finding out about what we do. We get a chance to ask you guys directly on what you want. So, yes?
How do you get in contact with your figures in Japan?
We go to Japan. Yeah, we had to take that long 13-hour flight to Japan in economy coach class. Basically in the chair you're sitting in with less leg room. And we sit 13 hours and we go out there. And with Japan, it's very much a ask first kind of culture. So we had to send out emails, and eventually some people came back to us, the ones that do have English-speaking departments, because though we are learning, we are not fluent in Japanese, definitely not business Japanese.
We were also assisted by a few people.
Oh, yeah.
Senpai. I know that we were specifically referred to some of our vendors by Danny Chu.
Right.
When I reached out to him, he replied to me now.
I know. Do you guys know who Danny Chu is? Only one head is shaking, that's not enough heads. Okay, so Danny Chu, I think I always end up talking about Danny Chu at the end of this presentation, but Danny Chu is this guy, right? And if you read his backstory, he lived in Foster. Yeah, go right ahead.
Who asked the question?
Oh, he did. He grew up. Oh yeah, sorry. You knew Danny Chu, he gets something too. But basically, he grew up kind of like in a poor circumstance, foster care, all kinds of stuff. And then he worked really hard to travel to Japan every year, eventually working for people in Japan. And now he's actually part of the Cool Japan Group. And Cool Japan is an initiative from Japan trying to reach out to more people, more countries, and spread Japanese culture. And we ran into him at a meeting, and all I had to do was tell him what we were doing. He's like, that sounds awesome. And the next day, we received an email from a major vendor. You know, and that was a really big help. But that's basically what that Cool Japan kind of thing is about, is spreading culture. And we've been talking to them for the past couple of months to try to get a part of their, to be a part of their organization to help spread anime in different parts of the world. Because we actually have 20% of our business in Canada. And so that was kind of cool for us. We have people in Australia, what's that one that I never know how to say? Latvia?
Slovenia.
Slovenia. The custom forms, when sending stuff out to them, is awesome. It's like, no yak's milk, no this, no that. I'm like, what? And then one of them, one of those really like rare European countries just have a blank field on what you can send in there, so you can send them anything and they don't care. So that's really cool. Yeah, we take all the precautions in sending stuff internationally as well as receiving them. So all our items are licensed, officially produced. The food items also go through an exporting company, so we get them and they go through all the customs and then we send them out to you guys. So there's some other companies that sell some Japanese and anime stuff, but I highly question how authentic they are. Yeah. Yes.
As like a suggestion, would you have like a loyalty program?
Right. Like a referral program, or
maybe like after some you subscribe for some months, mm-hmm. maybe you get like perks every now.
Like that. Yeah.
We're toying around with a year subscription. And with the year subscription, you would get certain things like a special T-shirt or whatever. So people that would be involved with that would always just get that every year. They would just be expected. And so that's kind of what we're looking at with having a loyalty pump program. We were actually going to roll out our year subscription
last year.
There was a lot of things like that we wanted to add to it to actually make it more special. And I think we're going to roll that out sometime around Christmas.
Probably, yeah.
Or after, maybe the new year.
Yeah, just so that way we can make sure that everyone gets what they want from the service. We also do a holiday bento. Because we know that postage service is kind of slow in December, and people want to give them more than just a card or a sticker. We're probably going to be putting together a box that's going to go out before the Christmas time so that it can be delivered in time for Christmas. And that way, we know a lot of different people. Some parents are like, my kids love anime, but I know nothing about anime. And so this is kind of the great service for them. I talk to a lot of them. Those are my favorite people to talk to, me being a parent. And also, sometimes it's just like, I really want to relate to my kids, but I don't have the time to find new stuff all the time for them. So we do it for you, And it works the same way for the people who are interested but have busy lives. I mean, this is like my sixth or eighth weekend going to conventions. I've only had 1 week off, and I have so much anime to watch when I get home. So I gotta watch it, it's a job now, it's a job. So.
Choose it as a gift.
Oh, well, I'm glad you're saying the word gift, because we actually have gift subscriptions. Yes, where, as you can see up there, you can give it as a gift. So you make the purchase and you put in the information, and an email gets sent to the person saying, hooray, someone loves you, here's an anime box. And they click on claim, and they put in all their information, and at no cost, they receive the box. So that's how our gift service works, yeah. It's great for like a birthday or something. Who had a question? Oh, well, we'll get that guy then. Yes.
When you do a holiday, do you do it based on the holiday, like if there's an anime, like a Christmas thing, or holiday?
It's really going to be based off what's releasing around then. Because we do the pre-order now, and we get what we get. And that's the hardest part about ordering.
Yeah. Sometimes people are like, can we have a Naruto box? And I'm like, that would be awesome. But no, there's just not enough Naruto stuff at a given point in time. We would have to basically save up a whole year's worth of merchandise to finally put it out. By the time we put it out, it's old stuff. You probably already got it from the con tables and such. And that's kind of the issue we have. That's why we also want to create content at one point where we get the licensing rights. We work with Funimation. Funimation has expressed interest in making a Funimation box where it's all of their titles in one box. And we're like, well, if you sell us the stuff, we'll put it together, that kind of stuff. People love Funimation, people love Crunchyroll. We want to work with these industries to help grow and give people what they like. Yes?
So I guess a suggestion or maybe something you may have thought of, have you thought about like a builder's bento, like, Gunpla and what model kits that as part of it?
That would be cool.
It has a higher price point.
Yeah. Well, you were talking about doing a premium box, so right, that would be something like along those lines.
Yeah. So like the builder ones, yeah. And then maybe you could select if you're like a...
I didn't hear it.
Basically, he said if we could do like a Gundam box where you build your own stuff.
So it's like a specific bento for builders. Like,
right.
It's
right.
Yeah.
Okay. Throw me a peace sign back there. 2 minutes? Okay. Yeah, so, that sounds like a really good suggestion. And I will remember that. And that's the kind of stuff that we need, because I don't put Gundams together because it takes too damn long. So if someone were to tell me, like, hey, there's a lot of people who like that. I know Bluefin, they're local distributors. They have really good Gundam stuff. I know people were like Kaiju Box. They wanted like all the monsters from like, someone like Kaiju? Yeah, like a Kaiju Box, which are all the monsters from Godzilla. Someone said a Toku Box, which is like Power Rangers stuff.
Do we want to mention the box we got requested a lot in LA?
Oh, I don't know. Is everyone here 18 plus?
H-Box?
Yeah, just to let you know, yeah, an H-Box. That's actually the code name for it that we... Yeah, we've talked to a couple of people, a couple of shady people that hang around the booth. But yeah, I mean...
It's been heavily requested, and so we're looking into it.
Right.
Me, who does all the purchasing, I can't even fathom how to put one together.
Yeah,
were you at
there? Yeah, we were at it. Yeah.
Did you, I guess,
yes, that's who we talked to.
Actually talked to him.
Yeah.
He got buddy-buddy with
him. Yeah, that guy's cool. The stories that guy tells you is pretty awesome. It makes you blush. But, that's what we're trying to figure out. What kind of things people are interested in. What are they wanting to receive on a monthly basis? And that's kind of the model that we use is, what is something that people are constantly collecting? What are they wanting to add to their collection? And how do we get it to them in the most convenient, easy fashion, as well as a good price? Because of course, you guys don't want to buy a $500 box that has figures in it all the time and it full-size figures, because that's $500 you guys have to pay every month. And you know, only the people like me who have addictions do that, so. I spent $1,000 at AX on spending stuff. Yeah? Okay, so as vendors, they invite you to the warehouse parties, where you get to go to the warehouse that actually ships all the stuff to the vendors and they sell it to you at wholesale. Man, kid in a candy shop, man. It was like midnight by the time we were out there. There's no aircon, we're sweating. They just fed us tacos. It was a bad scene, but yeah. It's a lot of fun being part of this business, and as you can hopefully tell, it's a lot of trying to get it right for you guys to make sure that you're happy with it. We've been working a lot on our customer service to try to get that even better for you all. We just started a new support page that people can request things on, and you guys can always email us. Our Facebook is pretty active. That's probably the best way to communicate with us, and because it goes right to my phone. So. And we really appreciate anything that you guys do to help us out. Anything that you guys can suggest is good for us. And if you guys want to talk to us some more or have any more questions, we'll be at our booth. It's all the way in the back of the vendor table area. And we're the ones with the Moe Chan 5-foot cutout made. So if someone already tried to steal her, I was very upset at that. That's my waifu.
Or we'll be walking very slowly back.
Yeah. It'll be 20 minutes. I'll see you then. Thank you guys. Thank you.